Hello, welcome to Langwe Camp in the middle of Vindu National Park in Gabon. This is our camp. And we have Dubai about 3 kilometres down to the east. So behind us is the office, and we also have a kitchen with a gas cooker and a dining room. This is one of our shelter platforms for the tents. We've just recently treated it for termites around the bottom. And soon we'll treat all the rest of the wood as well, because the termites are quite a problem here. You've got a lot of humidity, and with this wood touching the ground, it's very attractive for the termites. So this has been my house for the last just over a year. A lovely big tent, which is more like a marquee, and inside I have a double bed, so it's not really rough in it, it's quite luxurious camping. Before I arrived, and for the first couple of months I was here, for power we had to use a generator, which in a place like this is quite unpleasant because it's very noisy and it only runs for an hour or two a day, and for all of the fuel we had to carry it in by hand. So we'd be walking up and down from the Boodle of Peace with a jerry can full of fuel for running the stuff in the evening to charge computers. We have here our solar panels, which are connected to these batteries. And inside is a charge controller and an inverter. The panels that give us power is actually a bit more than we need, really. We never get low on electricity. It'd be nice one day to pop these on top of the roof and get them out of the way, because they're not the most attractive things in the middle of the camp here. Whilst the project was shut down for a few years, unfortunately a mouse moved into this box here and made itself at home in all the wiring and chewed things up and disconnected wires and snapped them in half and all this sort of thing. So one of the first things I did was to replace all that wiring. Replace a few of the breakers that are broken, reinstall the lightning arrestor, and after that we were able to individually charge each battery and repair them, and then reconnect the solar panels, the battery and charge controller, and this now provides all our power in camp. So with this we can charge our computers, we can charge our batteries for GPSs and for phones and all this sort of thing, and that runs 24/7 and doesn't make too much noise. It's very self-sufficient and eco-friendly, and we have lights, and we can eat our food in the light rather than have to do it by the light of head torches, which is what we did for the first few months. So communication here is quite difficult. Obviously there's no phone reception this far away from civilization. We used to rely on just the satellite phones, but they're fairly unreliable and very expensive. So after I fixed up the solar power, I repaired the antenna which is outside, and we can now use this HF radio to talk between here and Vindu, the logistics base, and organise movements and supplies of food and all this sort of thing. And that's free and it doesn't cost anything, so it's good. Oui, 2 segments pour le grand si.
2 segments pour la
Oui, c'est ça. On a besoin de sel aussi, un paquet de sel.
Oui, un paquet de sel aussi, oui.
C'est tout?
Merci.
Ok, c'est tout. So in the next month or so, we're going to be using this wood and some more wood that's stuck in another tent site up there to rebuild a shower and a water tower and various other repairs around camp. At the moment, we wash in a stream, which is just over here, which is quite nice, but it's not awfully ecological because the stream eventually arrives at Dubai. So any pathogens, any soap, anything like that that we dump into the water eventually reaches down there. It's probably filtered by quite a distance of stream, but it's still not a good thing to be doing. So with a water tower and a shower, the soil will filter out anything that gets dropped in the water before it reaches the river.
and the water tower will give us running water, so we can have running water in the kitchen and we can have a shower and all this sort of thing. So that'd be quite high tech. So
down at the bay at the moment, we've got a horrible tarpaulin just lying across some planks. So every time it rains, you've got to pack all our optics away and all our cameras and all our lenses and stuff, because it's not very safe. And obviously it rains quite a lot here, so that doesn't really work. So we're going to put a nice Apex roof on. This is going to be a Kume. We're going to have some nice onduline sheets to go on top. And then up at the camp, first of all, we're going to put up the water tower. And then from the water tower, we can connect the shower and the kitchen. At the moment, we wash in a stream, which isn't the best solution because that water eventually goes down to the bay. So to reduce our impact as much as possible, we have a composting toilet. Anything that goes into there after 6 months or so is broken down in just kind of like a peaty soil that can then be put out onto the side. It doesn't smell and it doesn't contain any pathogens. That all gets killed off by the heat. So rather than having to dig lots of long drops or anything like that, we can use this one.
Okay, merci, bonsoir. Oui, demain, le beach.
For the work here, the biggest problem is just the logistics. It's remote, there's no road access, it's in the middle of nowhere, so anything we want to bring in first has to travel for about 2 hours by car, and then gets left at the Bout de l'Epice at the end of the road in the forest, and then after that we have to hike with it for another 2 hours. So for everything from gas bottles for the cooker, which weigh quite a lot, we have to carry that on our backs. Any kind of equipment, any kind of tools, anything like that has to be brought in from Ivindu. And even at Ivindu it's not very easy, there's no road access to Ivindu itself. Either everything has to come on the trains, which aren't very reliable, or they have to come to one side of the Ivindu River, and then they have to be walked across a railway bridge to the other side of the Ivindu River, and then picked up by a second car and brought back to the village. So by far the biggest problem really is just the fact it's a difficult site to work at. Over here, that's the bridge that you crossed there when we drove down here to the village. You slept there last night, and then this morning the drive takes us up along here, and that's the 30k diversion that I was talking about. There used to be the path along here, but that's now broken, so we can't drive along there. So we do this diversion up to here and carry along, and this is Camp Dilo, and then this is the buffer zone of the park in light green here, and eventually we arrive on the edge of the park, and that's the elephant bridge. We carry on up to here, and that's 75 kilometers in total. And then from there, we get out of the car and we load up our backpacks, and we walk the final about 8 kilometers into camp, which is here. And then from camp, we do another 3 kilometers along this path down to the bay. The reason we're here really is Langwe Bay, which is a very important clearing for all sorts of species, but especially elephants. You can have a huge number of elephants at any one time. You can have up to sort of 78 individuals in the daytime, and probably more at night, but we're not quite sure exactly how many at night, because it's quite difficult to count them when it's dark. Is because partly as just a presence, if there's a presence here, it will discourage other people from coming into this area and approaching. Bays unfortunately are very easy places to approach because the animals come to you, so you can sit in the border with a gun and just wait for things to come to you, so that's not brilliant.
terms of monitoring, when we're monitoring the population of elephants and other species, we can begin to detect changes in the population. And if we find, for example, that the number of large tusked males is declining year on year, that can be an indication of poaching. And they'll have the larger tusks and they're more likely to be poached. So that's one aspect. Other aspects is things like the health of the population. With gorillas, we've noticed recently that there's a skin condition which we think is yours, which is a kind of syphilis, and affects gorillas and mostly silverbacks and adults. We're monitoring every time a group comes into the bio, we assess how many individuals are infected, the extent of their infection, whether it seems to be causing them any problem with feeding or anything like that, and then with the data we can detect whether there's a reduction in reproductivity or an increased mortality in different individuals. In the forest we have a few other little projects as well. Until recently we've been doing phenology, which is the monitoring of kind of the cycles of plant growth and plant reproduction. So when things flower, when they fruit, when they come into leaf and all this sort of thing. And with that data we can use that along with the elephant data and the gorilla data to partly explain why and when animals visit the bay, and partly to assess things like the effect of climate change. If things start flowering earlier or flowering later or coming into leaf earlier or later, then it's an indication that something is changing. Other things we do here around the camp, we survey for invasive species. Wasmania is quite a big problem in Gabon. It originally came from South America and it was mostly brought in by exploitation, so logging and oil exploration, all this sort of thing. Where you find Wasmania, you typically don't find any other ant species because the Wasmania either outcompete them or eat them. So that's not something we want to do, and that has huge knock-on effects. It doesn't sound like a big problem if you've just got a different kind of ant, but everything feeds back, so these ants affect the insects and the invertebrates, and that feeds up to the next sort of level and the bird species and all this sort of thing, so it's quite a big problem. And obviously we don't want to introduce anything that shouldn't be here ourselves, so we monitor for the presence of, for example, Wasmania. We have sticks dipped in peanut butter which are left around the edge of the camp and checked every so often to see what species of ant are feeding on them. So we obviously want to reduce our impact as much as possible whilst we're here. So we're going to go and look at a tanga tree, which is Dacroides bretoneri. It's a very tasty fruit. And then we're going to go up to the top of the hill and have a look at a camera trap and see if there's anything caught on the card. These are a tanga, but they're a little bit old now. This is a camera trap. It takes these big batteries. This is actually quite an old one, but back in the day it was quite a good one for being old, so it's still quite good quality. This is infrared LEDs. We've got the sensor in here and the camera lens here. So when an animal crosses a path or comes along this path, it will snap a photo. So that was about 40 metres from the camp, about 10:30 at night. That's the elephant having a go at the camera. She comes in, notices it, has a little sniff. That's probably the inside of his trunk. Backs off a bit, decides to head off in another direction. Wow, there's his little sister. That's quite an unusual one, really, really pale. Probably an old male. It's quite a nice shot. That's a golden cat, Chat Dore. And lots of bikers up there. That's the Cephalope Adojon, yellowback diker. That's a little blue diker. Another blue diker. So the third kind of monitoring we do at the bay is something called systematic scan sampling, where every certain period of time we use 30 minutes. The number of animals from six focal species are counted when they're in the bay. So for example, at 8:30 we'll count 15 elephants and 10 gorillas and 20 sisatunga. And that's repeated every 30 minutes throughout the day, every single day that we're there doing monitoring.
Par éléphant, le gorille, le sita, potamocher, je suis là depuis fort longtemps. Les quatre coins, je les connais très bien, surtout avec WSS, et particulièrement dans le parc de Livindo, j'ai découvert beaucoup de choses, j'ai appris beaucoup de choses. La forêt gabonaise, dans ce parc, j'en sais rien.
There's a lot you can learn from that. You can learn about the frequentation of the bye by these various species, you know, what time of year they come, whether it's during the rainy season, whether it's during the dry season. In combination with the phenology data, you can work out if they're coming to feed on a certain kind of plant, or if they're coming because there isn't very much other fruit available in the forest. And also it's quite important for tourism.
C'est souvent en saison de pluie. Il y a aussi des arbres qui sont dans en saison de pluie.
If you don't know what animals to expect at a bye, you can't guarantee somebody, oh yeah, you're going to see elephants, yeah, you're going to see sitatunga. Whereas if you know how they use the bye and at what period they're likely to come, you can say, well, 70% chance of seeing it. And don't come during this other time of year when there's not very much visiting the bye. Other projects for the future, there's a few things that we want to get done. A lot of which depends on funding, but if we can find the funding for it, there's a few things we want to do. One of them is to extend the camera trapping network. At the moment, we've just got a few cameras just here and there in the forest, nothing very systematic. But if we receive the funding, we would buy maybe 30 camera traps and put them around the south of Indian National Park systematically and in places where we think we're likely to find signs of poaching and other kind of intrusion into the park. And with that, we can assess changes in population. You can index abundance and animal density by using the camera trap data. And then at the same time, we're putting out these camera traps. We can be doing, they're called recce walks, which is kind of a systematic way of moving through the forest, recording signs of animals in terms of dung and feeding signs, and also signs of humans, so things like machete cuts or footprints or shotgun casings or carcasses, anything like this. The second project that we're thinking about doing, if we can get the funding, is a chimp habituation program up in the north of the park towards a place called Nasuna, which was an old forestry station. People from WCS have reported finding naive chimps. With great apes, it's normally very, very difficult to do a habituation program because they're quite intelligent animals and it takes a very long time. So, for example, for a gorilla habituation project, it could take up to 10 years. So it's something you really have to think about and have to be committed to. And with these chimps, if they're naive, it means you don't have to overcome their initial fear of human beings before you can begin the habituation. So rather than having to spend 5 years proving that you're not poachers and proving that you're not there to damage their group, you can move straight in and their natural curiosity will draw them to you slightly. And then after that, you can begin to habituate them. And then eventually that would be handed over to ANPN as a kind of tourism product. At the moment, Langwe Bay is probably the best place in Gabon to see wild gorillas. And you can see them fairly regularly, you know, sort of every other day they come into the bay. But chimpanzees don't visit bays, and so the only way to see them really is in the forest. And if they're wild populations, it's very, very difficult to follow them. If it was a habituated population, you could sort of guarantee a tourist could come and see the chimpanzees somewhere wild in the forest. A little cicada, well, a big cicada. We found it in the stream by Langwe Cat.